So shall we now move on to item number 5, which is promotion of inward investment. And we are looking at paper 5CB1550/1516/05. The Secretariat has also provided us with a background brief, which has been circulated to members as well. And this is CB1550/1516/06. In attendance today, we have Permanent Secretary for the Commerce and Economic Development Bureau, Mr. Liu, and Ms. Yi Xiu-Wai, Deputy Secretary. From Invest Hong Kong, Mr. Fok, and Ms. Song Si Hong, Assistant Director. So welcome to you all. This is the beginning of the new year. I would like to first of all wish you a Happy New Year. So we didn't have any filibustering for the first item, so we were able to finish our discussion quite speedily. So the next item is about promotion of inward investment. Permanent Secretary, will you please walk us through the paper? Thank you. And we hope that we'll be able to work closely with the panel in the year of the monkey. Today, we've come here to brief you on our work plan for this year. Invest Hong Kong has all along been promoting the competitive advantage of Hong Kong, attracting, you know, enterprises from Taiwan and other countries to set up headquarters in in Hong Kong. In the last few years, more than 3,800 businesses have come to set up office in Hong Kong. And during the first year when they set up their office in Hong Kong, they have created more than 40,000 jobs. In 2015, although the global economy was facing different challenges, but our colleagues in Invest Hong Kong had worked hard and assisted 375 mainland Taiwan and overseas companies to set up offices in Hong Kong or expand their business. And this is a historic high. Of the 375 projects, they generated a total of direct investment amounting to $10 billion. And in the first year of the expanding the business, they've also created about 3,600 jobs in Hong Kong. And this is recognition of the work of the of Invest Hong Kong and shows that we have all the favorable factors that will enable us to continue to attract foreign businesses to come to Hong Kong. In 2016, the global economy is still facing uncertainties, and our colleagues at Invest Hong Kong will need to work doubly hard to encourage and promote mainland and overseas companies to invest in Hong Kong. We will work in tandem with the government's policy and step up our efforts, and also focusing on the mainland and emerging markets such as the ASEAN countries. And we would also step up the promotion of Hong Kong as a place for startup businesses. So that roughly would be my introduction. And we welcome questions from members. Mr. Charles Mock, I will not be setting a time limit because we have abundant time. Thank you, Chairman. I also like to wish everybody a Happy New Year before I ask my question. I understand that in recent years, Invest Hong Kong has been promoting and helping businesses in different jurisdictions, especially the IT industries, to come and invest in Hong Kong, for example, the Start Me Up campaign. And this time you have diversified into you've organized different activities in the same week. And I think, be it the FinTech seminar, they have proven to be very successful. So it would appear the focus of many of these campaigns and activities are on the startups. And this is actually in parallel with the government's policy direction. For example, the ITB is also promoting startup and businesses in Hong Kong. But still, we hope that there could be ways for us to attract more mature enterprises to come to Hong Kong and to expand their presence here, especially in terms of the creation of employment. We've heard the Permanent Secretary telling us that that 40,000 jobs have been created. What's the time frame that you are referring to? It's since the establishment of Invest Hong Kong. So that's a very long time for companies coming to Hong Kong to set up offices. During the first year of the operation, they would be able to create new jobs. I'm more concerned about the number of jobs that will be created in future, I hope. But you say that since the beginning, when Invest Hong Kong was set up, it's been a very long time actually, more than 10 years. So the figure you gave us does not fully reflect how effective or otherwise your efforts have been. So perhaps you could give us more information. Other than the aggregate numbers, could you tell us what sort of jobs have been created? Say, for example, let me talk about my own industry, the IT industry. The VDC has conducted surveys and found that in the last 8 to 10 years, work of a supporting nature have actually replaced, jobs which actually develop new technology and so on, and salaries paid to the people are also reduced. So I'd like to know whether Invest Hong Kong can, I think if the government really want to promote the development of the IT industry, I hope that you can really attract these businesses to create good quality jobs. For the startups, many of them are actually not in a very secure position and not making a profit yet. However, if we could attract the more mature companies to come to Hong Kong to do R&D work, that would be very important, especially for our younger generation. In recent years, Singapore has been doing this for many years, and they have been very successful. But even Taiwan has been very active in the last few years. Apple, for example, had rarely done the R&D overseas, but they have now set up some R&D centers in Taiwan. So are we able to attract these, famous brands to come to Hong Kong to do something that's similar? I'm sure this will certainly, be attractive to young people when they and also give them the incentive, for example, to pick those subjects when they pursue their studies. I'll start and Mr. Kok Choi can supplement. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Mok for his comment, and we're grateful to you for your recognition of the activities that we've organized. I think those activities have achieved very good results, which shows that Hong Kong could be a hub for startups. We were able to attract not only those doing startup entrepreneurs in Hong Kong, we were also able to attract startup entrepreneurs from other countries to come to Hong Kong, and so that they could share the experiences and learn from each other. Regarding the number of jobs created, having heard members' comments, in future, when we conduct our analysis, we will consider whether we can provide more details. So, because we can certainly follow up on how these companies, having come to Hong Kong, how they have developed and so on. And also, after they've set up the office in Hong Kong, how have they developed? Last year, we conducted a follow-up survey on these companies to find out about these companies which have set up offices in the last few years in Hong Kong. And we found out that these companies which responded to our survey, most of them are still operational in Hong Kong, and they have hired quite a number of people. Regarding technology, for the next year, this, I think one of our priority is to attract foreign companies to come and invest in Hong Kong. Assistant Director, thank you. Mr. Mok was asked a very good question. We have all along been working with the Science and Technology Park and Cyber Port as to how we can attract foreign overseas companies to invest in Hong Kong at the Science Park. Regarding R&D work for high value added industries, GCL will be setting up the R&D center to Hong Kong. We've also seen that a few years ago, Huawei set up the first R&D center at the Science Park, and they have been growing the business here. And there is a shortage of certain talents in Hong Kong. They will attract talents from outside coming to Hong Kong. We attach a lot of importance to this project. When we talked to the companies, they told us that Hong Kong has provided a very good platform. Many mainland companies are willing to set up an R&D center in Hong Kong so that in Hong Kong they would be able to invite elite R&D personnel to come to Hong Kong, because some people may not want, these talents may not want to work in the mainland, and this is where in Hong Kong we have the advantage of the free flow of information, and these talents think that in terms of a place where they work or live, they would prefer to choose Hong Kong. So these companies are steadily coming to set up offices in Hong Kong, and we're also encouraging them to place their R&D center here. We've been also working with overseas companies. We conduct roadshows to the Silicon Valley and London and Cambridge every year, and also Germany as well, and Sweden. For companies doing high value added businesses, we would attract them to set up R&D centers. The MIT Information Center, they want to set up an information node here. And we've been encouraging them to place some R&D element in Hong Kong, because they think that the platform which Hong Kong and the PLD Delta can provide really does an advantage, especially for because this is the nowhere in the world do we have a place with all the favorable conditions to enable them to expand the business. For the financial industry, some companies, for example, CGC, Corporate Treasury Center, we hope that they will place their center in Hong Kong or set up the center in Hong Kong. These are, we're talking about high value added, businesses, startups that can really, create employment as well. Just one supplement, Chairman, and I'll defer to other members. In future, I hope you will consider certain, target industries and sectors. If you only conduct roadshows, I believe that for some industries and companies, they you should be able to attract these target companies to come and invest in Hong Kong. You talk about the competitive advantages of Hong Kong. On the other hand, I've heard many people saying that it's difficult to attract R&D talents coming to Hong Kong because they are not able to hire sufficient talents in Hong Kong. It's a chicken and egg question. The market is not big enough. In the past, students would prefer to study finance and would not pursue a career in science and technology. So the ITB is now coming up with new initiatives. So I hope that in future you can really, coordinate better. So the Education Bureau, what are they doing? For example, different departments are working on their own. I hope that several bureaus can work, coordinate better, especially in resolving the problem of the shortage of talents. Many of the companies we approached told us that this is the big main issue. Thank you, Mr. Mok. we certainly would work along that direction to see how we can do better. Whether at the level of the Bureau or Invest Hong Kong, we will work with the other bureaus and departments. I also mentioned the Science and Technology part. We certainly work closely with them, and if we could work together, we will certainly, you know, work hard to do better. If there are no other questions from members, I would ask one myself. We all seen that the political climate in Hong Kong is deteriorating. We even have riots now. So has that really, does that have a detrimental effect on your promotion of Hong Kong overseas? In the course of your promotion, have you encountered any barriers or obstacles? Chairman, I'll start and then my colleagues can supplement. Of course, we really value Hong Kong's having a stable and peaceful environment. This is the reason why we're able to attract, inward investment. So when we promote Hong Kong externally, we always emphasize that Hong Kong is a place where there is a rule of law and it's a peaceful, society. And if anything should happen, the media and public opinion will really react very strongly. So we will actively, explain to those who are interested in investing in Hong Kong that Hong Kong still is a very stable and a very safe city with the rule of law. We still have a very efficient government and a very efficient police force to maintain law and order. And this is what we will always tell the foreign investors in the past and also going forward in the future. We'll do the same. Director. We have always maintained a close working relationship with the Chambers of Commerce and the foreign consulate offices. Very often the overseas companies would first made inquiries with those consulate officers about the situation in Hong Kong. Sometimes we would go on a roadshow together with these Chambers of Commerce and also consulate officers. In fact, they know very well the situation in Hong Kong. We always brief them on what the situation in Hong Kong is like. And these companies really appreciate the fact that we have a very open economy, and what is more important is that they see a potential here in Hong Kong for them to expand the business. In Southeast Asia, the economies of different countries is now going through a lot of turmoil, but the last 20 years, the World Bank or the IMF have seen a growth in Asia has exceeded almost 50%.
So where can they set up? In which city? Hong Kong is ideal, not only geographical location, but we also have the facilities and infrastructure. We have very close links with the consulates and also with the commercial councils, etc., etc. And we have explained to our customers, we have sent out the message as to how we are. And they seem to be assured, and they will continue to invest in Hong Kong. Now, it's been 30 years and more since the opening up of mainland China. And the commercial sector all over the world had been eyeing the huge market of China. And Hong Kong had been playing the role of the intermediary. Hong Kong is where the East meets West. It is a metropolis. We have a talent pool. We are familiar with the mainland and with the international arena. That is why a lot of international companies prefer Hong Kong. In stepping into the mainland market, they want to leverage on the advantages of Hong Kong. But more and more, China mainland is getting international. We, Hong Kong, as an intermediary, our role is diminished and continues to diminish. And now, we, with all these elements which turn violent at the drop of the hat, I think your work will be more strenuous in the future. Well, talk is cheap, isn't it? We talk about law and order, and there we have riots, fighting. Yes. You might have to put in more efforts, the government, because really for the business to be, for the businesses to prosper, you cannot have turmoil. How can you do business in Syria, Afghanistan, for instance? You have to have certain peace and stability. So I would think going forward in promoting Hong Kong and investment into Hong Kong, you probably have to redouble your efforts. Liu Changkong? Thank you, Mr. Chair. There are a few economic systems in Hong Kong, Singapore, India, for instance, have through international been attracting IT companies to invest in these places with certain concessions and benefits, the Singaporean government being one through tax concessions in 2013, the financial year. They, in their budget, they have offered their productivity and innovation taxation concession scheme. And this concession, tax concession scheme, will help develop their innovation business and IT business. Now, where appropriate, the companies will be able to get a bonus or an incentive of a dollar for a dollar. And for startups, it can enjoy 400 or up to 400% of deductions and exemptions. Now, Hong Kong, as a potential competitor, would you be considering, the Hong Kong government, will we consider companies, IT companies with potential to come establish their business in Hong Kong with concessions and tax benefits? Mr. Chair, we have always had the principle of fair competition in investing in the Hong Kong local economy. And all through the years, we would not provide any special concessions or benefits to any sector or any international businesses. And also, the Hong Kong tax regime is simple and the tax rate low. And this is already a huge attraction for overseas investors. And we provide a level playing field to all, and we want to therefore attract varied sources of investment. And also, our own SMEs can also, on a level playing field, compete with these international forces and coexist. We do have individual funds in helping different sectors to develop. For example, in IT, we already have innovative IT, and we have been working with enterprises in the field to develop funds. And also in January, in the policy address, the CE had also mentioned a number of new funds that the SAR government would be establishing to promote development in innovation and IT. Well, I hope with fairness, level playing field, and all these measures, Hong Kong will continue to be an ideal place of business for local businesses as well as overseas businesses. Well, Chair, I'm all for level playing field, I'm sure. But the whole world over is facing globalization. and we are facing overseas competition in terms of resources, talents, if we still hold true to age-old principles. I do not know whether this is losing at the starting point, really. Mr. Chair, of course, we will try to monitor the situation, but that is the policy that we hold. We will have measures to specifically address certain sectors, our priority sectors, to provide assistance. My colleague will supplement. Charles. Well, Hong Kong, compared to some other countries, you mentioned some other countries just now, they provide a lot of resources. And in Hong Kong, we have 18 to 20 funds, different funds provided or managed by different organizations. And the Hong Kong Productivity Council has an SME One Center with all the Hong Kong SAR offered benefits. And we have been talking with the entrepreneurs as well, the startup operators, especially for those which are just coming in and do not know where they want to start. We know that Singapore would throw resources at them, money. And we have been talking to these entrepreneurs, and they would rather choose Hong Kong over others as startup because they believe that Hong Kong has more opportunities with Shenzhen as our neighbor for manufacturing. That would be our base. And also we have funds. And then we have Start Me Up Hong Kong or startmeup.hk, which is our network for entrepreneurs. And we provide them with information as to the funding that we provide for them. Especially for the startup companies, they need the angel funding, first round, second round of such seed money. We will also match them up with angel investors in Hong Kong or these venture capitalists. So those all help them in their startup stage. In the past 3 years, our ecosystem for startups had been built up. Our co-work space, over 40 of them, started off with three only. They also provide a lot of resources from the government, the 20 funds that I've alluded to, as well as other resources in helping these startups. So we believe that this is very important, that is to help them and support them in their startup stage to know where to go for resources and to use Hong Kong as a platform to expand on their business. Next, Invest Hong Kong would of course want to attract overseas companies to invest in Hong Kong. I'm looking at para 21 here, and it says that the mainland is our biggest market. What does it mean? Are you saying that the biggest source of investment is from mainland companies? That for one. And secondly, under the security branch, there is commercial immigrants. Apart from coming to Hong Kong to establish companies from these mainland companies, if the boss feels that there are opportunities in Hong Kong, they would want to come and reside for long term in Hong Kong and continue to operate their business here. I know the Commerce and Industry Department is not responsible for this, but rather the security. But as far as I know, it is not favored for the staff of the companies to follow the boss, the owner of the business, and come to Hong Kong and live and work here. Because according to my knowledge, for people coming, mainlanders coming to Hong Kong to operate the business and live here, they will have to give up their hukou in the mainland. So they have to, one, forsake their hukou or huxi in the mainland and come to Hong Kong, apply to Hong Kong, and at the end of the day, they may not be granted the Hong Kong residency. I would like to know how this is handled. On the one hand, you want to attract these mainland companies to Hong Kong, but it seems that the biggest single source of investment is indeed from the mainland, but the owner of the operations, if they want to come and reside in Hong Kong, it seems that there are great hurdles. That is my question. Mr. Ho will answer that question. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chung, for the question. Now, there's 78 companies. In 2015, we have completed 315 projects, 78 of them come from the mainland. These 78 projects include, in terms of services that we provide, we introduce to them one-stop shop and also the business environment in Hong Kong and where their senior management need to come to Hong Kong to work and need to be seconded to Hong Kong if they need to find offices or residences. We provide such introduction services. Now, Mr. Chung was talking about immigration, immigrating into Hong Kong. We have so far very few of such requests for assistance. Generally, it would be about sending of senior management from SOEs and also big private companies. And these senior management would probably be the CFO or human resources directors. And if we should receive requests for assistance where the boss himself, the owner of the business himself, wants to come reside in Hong Kong, we will definitely follow up with each and every case together with the Immigration Department. Well, I'm sure many of the companies coming to Hong Kong and the senior management would come to Hong Kong and work a few years and then go back to their original location. That is also the case with many overseas companies. Now, what I'm saying is that some senior management and business owners want to actually emigrate to Hong Kong and live here for the long term. I mean, Invest Hong Kong's purpose is to attract more companies, in particular mainland companies, to establish business in Hong Kong. Now, if the bosses want to stay here, there is now no mechanism in helping them to do so. Now, from what Mr. Ho said, there are very few of such cases, but I hear your suggestion. And we have very frequent contact with these mainland companies. If we find there are many such cases, we are very happy to work together with Security and Immigration Department to see how we can better facilitate this kind of requests. Yes, we note the view expressed just now. Chair, I still have some time. Now, apart from the mainland companies, for overseas business owners, if they want to emigrate to Hong Kong or immigrate to Hong Kong, they do not have to give up their own nationality or citizenship before they come here. And basically, they can wait till Hong Kong grants the residency or the citizenship before they need to give up their own. But that is exactly the reverse for mainlanders. Well, from my own contact, mainlanders where they apply to Hong Kong for a visa, to Hong Kong SAR and Macau SAR, their mainland hukou will be cancelled. Now, the applying for the passport is different. For the entry and re-entry visa into Hong Kong and Macau, their mainland huxi or hukou is cancelled. I'm talking about mainlanders coming to Hong Kong. So these are application for immigration? No. These are new applications. Mainlanders applying for single trip. Single trip entry visa into Hong Kong and Macau. Their hukou or huxi in the mainland will be cancelled. And we cannot object. But there lies a problem. A lot of people, mainlanders, coming to Hong Kong who cannot adjust to the Hong Kong environment, when going back, they cannot reinstate their hukou or huxi. That is a separate issue, but it is a problem. Right. For if we do not have overseas investment and we rely only on local investment, we will never grow any bigger. And any developed city, and in particular us with our capitalist system and one country, two systems, we definitely would want to attract more investments in Hong Kong and grow our pie bigger. I think that is true for anybody. Now, what is most important is the positioning of Hong Kong. What is the positioning of Hong Kong? We have to know the positioning of Hong Kong. Do we want to be, we are an international world metropolis after the return of sovereignty. The CE says we want to be the super connector. And in the past period of time, we see that for a lot of our economic policies, we have been focused on the mainland. And that is fine, because the mainland market is huge. And there are a lot of mainlanders coming to Hong Kong to invest. We list mainland companies. A lot of bosses want to come. And we have the individual visas coming to Hong Kong. But in the next period of time, in the future, I think the government will have to tell us all what is the positioning. In terms of our economic development, we all know about the HSBC situation or incident between Hong Kong and London. HSBC chooses London as the place of domicile. And the finance ministry in Great Britain says that it is because of HSBC's confidence in the economy of the UK. So what is our positioning? Do we continue to aspire to be a international metropolis, or do we want to be a window for mainlanders to invest? You know, the two may be a trade-off. We have to, perhaps, choose between the two. So strategically, what is the positioning of Hong Kong? Otherwise, we will just be bumbling everywhere, and we will end up nowhere. In attracting investments, we have three major foci. One, where we are successfully traditional successful in Hong Kong, finance, logistics, transport, and telecommunications. These are the three pillars that we want to attract more foreign investment into. Second focus, in terms of startups and entrepreneurs, we would want Hong Kong to be a hub for startups. As mentioned in January, we have a major activity for promotion of startups. That's one such effort. Three, we want to be a super connector for mainland companies using Hong Kong to go outside, or international companies using Hong Kong to explore the China market. We would want them to use Hong Kong as a base. So these are the three foci for the next few years. Chairman, I still have a bit of time, yes? Indeed. Why do I bring up positioning? After the return of sovereignty, Hong Kong, SAR, is of course a part of China. That is beyond doubt. Anything we do, there is competition. Do we, in the future, compete with Guangzhou and Shanghai? I'm sure they'll be a lot more prosperous, and there can be virtuous competition as well. Or do we want to position ourselves vis-a-vis Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, the four little dragons in Asia. Now, these two are different positionings, you understand. I would want to know what our strategy is. You mentioned just now, we want to be an international financial hub, logistics hub. We have been so. Do we want to be an IT hub? Apart from international financial and logistics hub, our future development is to develop into technology or in intelligence. Is that so?
I think the competition that we now face is different from what it used to be. Internationally and regionally, there are other cities which are rapidly developing, and the mainland economies has also developed in leaps and bounds. So whether we're facing regional competition or competition from the mainland economy, which is expanding, whether we are, you know, facing overseas foreign cities and mainland cities, we hope that Hong Kong will be able to be, you know, at the top of the league in terms of financial services, logistics, and new industries like innovative technologies. We hope that Hong Kong can maintain a leading position in those sectors. I believe this is a major objective for our Bureau. Chairman, we have plenty of time, so let's have more exchanges. I'm still concerned about Hong Kong's positioning because it involves the strategic development of Hong Kong. We're talking about the development, the direction of a development. Once you position yourself, then you will need talents. If you position Hong Kong and benchmark yourself against Korea, Singapore, and so on, then we will need to train different types of talents. That we may need to invest in different types of talents. We need to consider which are the companies and foreign companies and products that we want to attract to Hong Kong. We want to become the best city in China. That we are even better than Shanghai. So we have a different positioning because we focus on finance and renminbi, and then we would develop our talents accordingly. Once you position yourself, only then will other people be willing to come and invest in Hong Kong. And it will make it easier for you to promote Hong Kong. If you develop a lot of talents when people come to invest in Hong Kong, you would hope that they will also hire local talents. So positioning is very important. So however you position yourself, you want Hong Kong to be in a leading position. But what I'm saying is that you should first position Hong Kong. So a positioning, as far as we're concerned, is that we need to maintain a leading position in the traditional industries where we excel, and also in the innovative industries. Only then would it be conducive to the long-term economic development of Hong Kong. In the work of Invest Hong Kong, we perhaps I can ask Mr. Ng to tell members about the feedback that we've heard from the business sector. Every time we promote Hong Kong overseas, our positioning is that for big companies, they will choose Hong Kong to set up the office in Hong Kong as the Asian, the office in Asia and globally. And the global CEO of Sanctions is also based in Hong Kong, GE as well. Other than doing business in the States, the global businesses are managed in Hong Kong. So these are very encouraging signs because different companies from different industries, big corporations from different sectors will place their Asian office in Hong Kong, and more so they will set up strategic functions here. If they want to, you know, expand the business in Southeast Asia, they would perform some of the functions in Asia, in Hong Kong, because we are a free port. They may also want to set up the corporate treasury center here. And secondly, we mentioned the R&D center, the command and control center. We had also encouraged them to set them up here in Hong Kong. The positioning is that different countries want to do business in Southeast Asia. They will pick a city, and we would encourage them to. We would define Hong Kong as a regional hub. So even if you want to do business in China or Southeast Asia, Hong Kong would be the center, at the center. For mainland companies, again, we are the platform to help them go global. The first stop would be Hong Kong, where they can set up the international operational arm. And they would use Hong Kong to expand globally. So we have a competitive advantage, you know, on both sides. Talking about the positioning of Hong Kong, let's say we have the 13th five-year plan, and recently the chief executive in his policy address also mentioned this. Hong Kong has the opportunity and the obligation to participate in the Belt and Road strategy, and I'm all for that. If we position ourselves as the super connector for the mainland, then other than positioning ourselves, we need to come up with strategies. There are more than 60 countries along the Belt and Road region. What plans and strategies do we have to encourage companies from those countries to come and invest in Hong Kong? Otherwise, you're merely, you know, relying on slogans. You say you'll participate, you know, in the Belt and Road initiative and the 13 five-year plan, but what specific actions will you take? The 60-odd countries are all different. Although they're all located along the Belt and Road region, the economic strength, the culture, and so on are all different. So how can you come up with the relevant measures to attract people from those 60-odd countries to invest in Hong Kong? You spend so much effort to attract, you know, inward investment from these countries, where in the past you focus on Europe and the States and Japan. And there are also so many enterprises from the mainland investing in Hong Kong. Do you have, you know, the ability to cope? How can your policy be so diversified to attract investment from so many different locations? Because the Belt and Road region involves many countries, whether it's logistics or finance or IT. I mean, do you really have the capacity or the ability or the manpower to really do that? So positioning of Hong Kong is very important. You cannot simply rely on slogans or do a little bit of everything. In the past, you talk about positioning Hong Kong based on the four pillar industries and so on. So Mr. Lam is correct. In our plan, it is most important that we have a focus, and we cannot, stretch ourselves too far because we have limited manpower resources. And also, to attract foreign investment, you cannot, do it overnight. This is something that takes a lot of time and patience. Coming back to the Belt and Road strategy, as we develop, encourage investment from the emerging economies, the Belt and Road region is one of the areas that will certainly, be interested in. So whether it's mainland or Southeast Asian economies with potential, we will focus our effort on those countries first. You're right in saying that we don't have the resources to cover all the countries along the Belt and Road region. So whether it's the target industries or the place where we want to attract investment, we need to adopt a focused approach so that we can really leverage on Hong Kong's competitive edge. Mr. Mok, Chairman, follow up on Mr. Liu's point. I think to attract, as I said in my, when I asked my first question, if you want to attract, big companies from overseas and quality companies to set up office in Hong Kong and create employment is very important. So I think this is related to what I was saying earlier, but the administration's response is such that they're only focusing on helping the startup businesses. Of course, this is not mutually exclusive. You told us that there are several dozens of funds that the startups can apply for, but I know that there are many companies which eventually have decided not to set up offices in Hong Kong, including some of the biggest computer companies. They've not chosen Hong Kong because of the problems of intellectual property rights. They originally wanted to come to Hong Kong, but you know, at the final moment, because those funds are too bureaucratic or rigid and were not able to accommodate some of their demand, as a result, these companies could not come to Hong Kong and the jobs have gone to other countries. Some of the large technology companies, I've heard of cases where they do want to come to Hong Kong, and some of the staff really want the company to set up base in Hong Kong, but because of certain red tapes, they were not able to. They know that in Hong Kong certainly will not be like Singapore, which offer so many incentives, but they would still like to get something, and then leveraging on Hong Kong's competitive edge, they would then come. Of course, the perks would be inferior to those offered in Singapore, but eventually they would still come to Hong Kong. But if you don't offer them anything, then they may not come here at all. And these companies could easily offer more than 100,000 jobs, which would then go to Singapore. Not to mention Google, which almost came and eventually did not. So, though of course, this is not a problem for Invest Hong Kong alone. They have to do with the policies of other bureaus. This is already, an issue involving different bureaus. The CITB has set up many funds. With the setting up of the CITB, you say it's not your responsibility anymore. May it's not directly your responsibility, but I still hope that after the bureau has been set up, you will wash your hands of this. In your response, you say there are still many such funds available in Hong Kong, but I was going to say that there are many examples that we've come across, and these companies told us that such funds, when we compare Hong Kong with Taiwan and Singapore, they tell us that we're not as flexible as those other jurisdictions which offer tailor-made incentives. Like the Permanent Secretary said, you want to be impartial in Hong Kong. But sometimes it's exactly because of this reason that we've lost some of the opportunities. So we must come up with a way that is both impartial and sustainable. It may not be so that we need to be consistent and then we adopt this rigid policy. That may not be the best policy, because there have been examples where companies eventually decided not to come for that reason. So I hope that among different bureaus, departments, you can consider how you can really, see how you can, resolve this issue. I'm sure you know what these companies are. So you must learn from them. Let's say we've lost this business, we're not able to attract this investor to come to Hong Kong. Would you find out what is the reason, and would you then see where you can really make improvement by way of the funds and so on? I'm not saying that you must offer tax incentives or what sort of incentives you must offer, but I still think that amongst the different departments and bureaus, you really need to address this issue. Don't always say that you need to be, impartial. Because there have been examples where we've lost many opportunities. Thank you. Of course, Mr. Mok has a lot of contact with industry and you have your point. But if we could make further relaxations to cater to the needs of industry, we'll be happy to explore the possibility. Secondly, we will, in our contact with the trade and foreign investors, if they have any concerns that they would like to tell us, then to quote the members, we'll be happy to adopt a more focused approach to find a solution. Whether it's the ITB or other bureaus, we work very closely together. If it is necessary for different bureaus to deal with questions related to investment, we certainly work together. Ms. Low Kok Wai and then Christopher Chung, Chairman. Actually, my question has been raised in previous years. And I'd just like to know whether the government could give us further information. Invest Hong Kong has attracted many companies to set up in businesses in Hong Kong. We're not just concerned about how they've done in the first year of operation and how many people they have hired, but rather, after operating for a few years, how have they been doing? Are the businesses sustainable? Are they able to expand the business in Hong Kong? In previous years, when we raised the question, the answer we were given was that it's difficult to collect such information, and those companies don't have the obligation to continue to provide the information to the government. But likewise, when we invest in the mainland, we have this experience. They really follow up on our investment, and the official statistics are the officials have a full grasp of the statistics. Last year. So I'd just like to know whether you have information regarding whether or not these foreign investments have been sustainable and so on. I'll say a few words and then my colleagues will supplement. Having heard the suggestion from members, we started to follow up on the businesses of these companies which have set up operations in Hong Kong. After they've set up their business in Hong Kong, we would continue to provide them with follow-up services. Perhaps Mr. Ho could further elaborate on the details. Thank you, Mr. Low. The panel has always been concerned about those companies after they have set up office in Hong Kong and what sort of follow-up support we offer them. In response to suggestions from members, in 2013, we've updated our mechanism, revamped our mechanism so that we will be able to follow up on projects which have been completed earlier in a systematic manner. We now have this requirement for our colleagues, that is, one, a project is completed, 12 and 18 months later, and 36 months later, we would meet with the client and follow up. In 2015, we've approached 331 investors which have come to Hong Kong in 2013-14, and 280-something are still operating in Hong Kong. When we contacted these organizations in the past year, they told us that they told us about the number of employees they have hired in Hong Kong compared, and the number has actually grown compared with the first year of operation in Hong Kong. We were not able to contact some of these companies because the contact person had left the company, or the company might have already moved, or in recent years we've been working on some of the startup enterprises which have gone through mergers and so on. After we have had this mechanism in 2013, we've been gradually accumulating statistics, and through analysis of these statistics, we can follow up on the progress of the projects that we've brought into Hong Kong. Mr. Mok mentioned the number of workers, employees hired by these companies. We will come up with a system to analyze better those figures. Other than monitoring whether these companies are still operating in Hong Kong, we also have follow up on these companies and see if they have any plan to expand the business. We'll follow up on those as well. We also would liaise with them through seminars to tell them about the latest situation in the Hong Kong market and so on. And for the more important projects, what we call the strategic projects. We would also periodically meet with those companies and see how we can assist them further so that hopefully they can consider moving the more important functions of the company to Hong Kong. Mr. Christopher Jung, the Permanent Secretary said that there are limited resources, but the Invest Hong Kong had all along been focusing on attracting investment from the traditional markets, but now you are exploring new markets like the Belt and Road region and Mexico. You're deploying more resources on those new markets and less on the traditional markets because those who wanted to come had already come. But whereas for the emerging economies, they do not know Hong Kong so well, and therefore and they are more attractive, you know, markets for us. And is that the reason why you are, devoting more resources to those markets? Of course, we need to be flexible. Once it's, decided on a plan at the beginning of the year, we will not blindly follow the plan without any changes. Perhaps Mr. Ng can explain to members about the flexibility of our strategy and how do we deploy our resources to focus on the more promising markets. Normally, we would look at our results every month. Our different units have been set their targets, specifying how many companies they will meet in a month. And we always closely monitor the results. Furthermore, for any emerging economies, if we see opportunities in any particular emerging economies, if the circumstances permit, if we see that there is a potential to then we will invite consultants through open tender to help us. And we will consider how many companies they can attract to Hong Kong every year. When there are new countries, Thailand and the ASEAN economies, we have invited a new consultant to help us look at those markets. We have been closely monitoring the different countries in the world and which are the markets with the most potential. We would not miss any such potential opportunities. As to how we allocate our resources, we would always, keep a close eye on the overall situation. So what are your criteria? How do you monitor the situation? Is it your criteria that you would focus on 5 or 10 companies and so on? I mean, how do you assess whether you've delivered the results? For each of the countries, if we think that that particular country is beginning to show a potential, our consultancy team, which we have engaged from outside, work on a part-time basis for us, then we would look at that market. When we first invited the consultants to work for us for a 3-day consultancy study or 5 or 6 or 10 days, we'll monitor the situation. If we think that there is a potential, then we would deploy more resources to it. I think we've worked for so many years and we've acquired a lot of experience, and we would rely on a system to look at how many projects should be awarded to each country. For example, if we could bring 5 projects from a country every year, then we will adjust the work for the consultancy accordingly. Well, Invest Hong Kong must decide on how the Hong Kong economy should position itself, and also decide what would be our target or objectives. It is right that we need to make optimal use of our resources, because no country and no city would have unlimited resources or manpower. It's not possible that you can do everything. You must focus on areas where you have your competitive edge. We always need to focus on areas where we have our competitive edges. That's what positioning means. The Belt and Road Initiative, we need to work on that. We need to work on the traditional markets as well. We need to maintain Hong Kong as a financial center, a logistics center, and so on. We see that there is potential in Mexico. You want to also develop that market. Same for Jakarta. It's like a buffet. You want to, you know, eat everything on the table. In the end, you simply will suffer from indigestion. So positioning is very important. Is it the case that even if you don't tell the people or the public or the investors, at least you should have some priorities in mind? For example, among the 50 countries, for the tourism ministry, we'll focus on those countries. For the manufacturing, we will be looking at those other countries. And for IT, these are the other countries that we'll look at. So you must have a list in mind. And on the list, then you would say, for these countries, you want to attract the small enterprises to come in Hong Kong. For example, the wife of Beckham is setting up shop in Hong Kong. So you may want to attract celebrities to set up business in Hong Kong. For the catering industry, you want to decide which are the restaurants you want to attract to Hong Kong. And then, as in the case when China opened up, it positioned the PRD region as an industrial city. Tongguan and Shenzhen have policy to attract, manufacturing and so on. And then they launched policies to attract factories in Hong Kong to move northward. And then they developed Qinghai. Qinghai will focus on the service industry. And now Shanghai has a different positioning. So even for the more backward economies like Cambodia, Myanmar, and Vietnam, they always have a clear position. They have positioned themselves. So for some industries, you may say that Vietnam was the target market. So you need to position yourself clearly and then tell the rest of the world, because you can't do everything. So you must come up with policies to attract the investment from those countries. Without positioning, proper positioning of Hong Kong, you wouldn't be able to come up with any policies. Thank you, Mr. Lam. I think you've made your point very clearly. To put it simply, for the coming year, we will focus, the major thrust of our promotion work will be focused on the mainland, Taiwan, and countries or emerging economies with potential along the Belt and Road region, such as the ASEAN countries. So these are the areas where we will focus our effort on in the coming year. Among these markets, we will promote our industries where we have our strengths, like finance and also innovative technology. So by adopting a focused approach, we can work more effectively.
Now, when Mr. Lam was out of the room, there was a question asked just now. And basically, we were not able to handle that issue. And in the next meeting, the administration will prepare the discussion of an item, which is the ETO to be established in Indonesia, in Jakarta. And so far, I've not heard any objections to that. But Mr. Lam here had suggested that you prepare the relevant information concerning the size of the Jakarta office, how many people, staff will there be, is it a rented place or a bought place, how is your preparatory work coming along, etc., etc. And also, given the Belt and Road Initiative, it is a major direction of development for the country. And definitely, it is not limited to the ASEAN countries. Will there be a cooperation, let's say, with the TDC in that effort? For example, perhaps the TDC can, along the Belt and Road countries, in the consulates, in the Chinese PRC consulates, perhaps provide a desk for us, Hong Kong SAR. Perhaps that is contemplatable. If you can provide such information analysis at the next meeting, that would be very good. And also for the Finance Committee in the future, for additional staff requests from you, this will pave the way. Well, definitely. I will provide sufficient information for members' discussion and consideration. Very good. Further questions? Yes. Lam Tai Fai. Mr. Chair, from various reports, we see that the tourism industry and the sectors related to tourism are really coming downhill. Now, I'm of course not here to talk about multiple visas from the mainland, etc. No. But rather, the fact is the tourism industry is doing badly in Hong Kong. And some are closing down, some are cutting staff, and it's affecting adversely the economy of Hong Kong. And I can see that continuing. So, can we perhaps in this panel discuss the tourism plight? Are you saying here in this panel or? Well, actually, the Economic Affairs Development panel, Monday of their meeting, their regular meeting, that is on the 22nd, there will be a, from the Tourism Development Council, an annual report. Perhaps we members in this panel can also join that meeting, so we do not have to have a separate meeting. Yes. Well, I think we can attend. We can always attend as lecture members. Well, I do not know the meeting time because I'm not a member of their panel. Well, perhaps we can ask the secretariat serving that panel, because the two are definitely linked and the ambits definitely connected. Very good. Yes, if you can contact the secretary in that panel, we will perhaps be able to participate as well. AOB. No other AOB. We close the meeting here. Thank you for coming.